Hello aspirants, welcome to coaching classes by Ash, and today I'll be taking your section 53A that deals with part performance. So section 53A is also known as Doctrine of Part Performance. So obviously my target audience is judiciary aspirants, law students, students who have opted law as an optional subject, and anyone who wants to know about Transfer of Property Act 1882, you people are most welcome here. So starting with our Doctrine of Part Performance, so these are my handwritten notes that I made during my LLB. So section 53A has five paragraphs. The first says about the transferor and the conditions that concern him. The second and the third talk about the transferee, what he should do to get the protection of section 53A. Fourth paragraph describes the nature of the protection that is given by the doctrine of part performance. And fifth para is a proviso protecting bona fide purchaser for the value without notice from the part performance doctrine. So what you have to keep in mind is that our section 53A has five paragraphs. If you read the Bayer language in your Bayer Act, you will get that it has been divided in five paragraphs. First one says about the transferor. Second and third talk about the transferee. Okay. Fourth para describes the nature of protection that is given by the doctrine, and the fifth para is a proviso that protects your bona fide purchaser for the value without notice from the part performance doctrine. Now, coming to our par points. These par points are the important points, and with the help of the par points, you can completely understand what your section 53A tells you. So, the first and the foremost thing, that a written contract must be where there is a contract to transfer any immovable property, obviously immovable property. The contract is written, signed by the transferor, and terms of transfer are ascertainable. That means they should be certain. And then there is a reasonable certainty, obviously. Then the second one is transferee. Remember, the second and third para talk about the transferee. So what it tells about our transferee? Transferee takes possession of that property in pursuance of the contract. Possession is on entire property or on part thereof. And it continues in possession if already in possession. Okay. So you have to continue it in possession if you have the possession, although you have partly performed the thing, but you have the possession and you are continuing taking the possession of the property. Then C says about the part performance by the doctrine. Okay, no, wait, we were on B only, yeah. Sorry, I just slipped it. So, second is it continues in the possession if already in possession. The third talks about it, that the transferee does some act in furtherance of the contract. So the transferee, that is the person to whom the property is transferred, he does some act in furtherance of the contract. The third C part talks about the part performance of the transferee. So, yeah. The first is the transferee has performed his part of the contract or is ready and willing to perform his part. Okay. Then notwithstanding that the contract was not in a proper form or it was not registered, the consequences would be that if A to D, that is from A till here, are present, then what happens? The transferee or any other person claiming through him, that is his signee, legal representative or heirs, shall be debarred from enforcing any right over that property other than the right provided expressly by the contract. You will get it, I think, here. Yeah. Then, on the grounds that a deed was not registered or a deed was not in proper form. Now, there are exceptions to Section 53A, that Section 53A shall not affect the rights of a bona fide purchaser for value without notice of the contract or part performance thereof. Now, what is exactly part performance? See what happens when A transfers his property to B, okay, A is the transferor, B is the transferee. So what happens? There's a contract between A and B. Now, if B partly performs something for the furtherance of the contract, okay, that is he partly performs the thing that has been, for example, A asks to B that I'll sell you my house, you give me 50,000 rupees. Okay. B gives him 25,000 rupees. So he has partly performed the contract. So when A will say that I'll not give you my property now because you have not given me the whole sum, the law says that no, B was willing to take your property. That is why B gave you 25,000 rupees. So if B didn't want to take your property, why would B do something in the furtherance of the contract? So this is part performance doctrine. This is section 53M. Now to clear it more to you people. Yeah. See, whenever you write doctrine of part performance, Madison versus Alderson was the first case. Okay, Madison versus Alderson was the first case, and it is really very important. This case was in 1883. So according to this doctrine, when a person has taken possession of immovable property on the basis of a contract of sale, and he has either performed or is willing to perform his part of the contract, then he would not be ejected from the property on the ground that the sale was unregistered and legal title has not been transferred to him. Okay, now got my point, what I was saying earlier. So if a person is willing to perform the contract or a part of the contract, then he will not be ejected from the property. So this was held in the case of Madison versus Alderson. Then after Madison versus Alderson, Madison followed in the, you know, Muhammad Musa's case. So these two cases, Madison versus Alderson, Muhammad Musa's case, are important whenever you write section 53A. You have to mention these both cases for getting more numbers. And the next very important case is Arif versus Jadunath. You don't have to write the whole summary of the thing. You have to write what the Privy Council's view was in this Arif versus Jadunath case. So Privy Council held that it was definitely declared the doctrine of part performance was inapplicable to India. So it can be asked in your free that doctrine of part performance was held inapplicable in India by the Privy Council in which of the following cases? And you will be given four cases. Arif versus Jadunath, Madison versus Alderson, Muhammad Musa's case, or Carrel versus Carbolic Smoke Ball Company. Okay, any case, so you have to take Arif versus Jadunath. The Arif versus Jadunath case was a case where doctrine of part performance was held inapplicable in India. Now, what acts constitute part performance? So, an act of part performance must be an act done in performance of the contract, and therefore acts introductory and previous to the agreement cannot be the act of part performance. And now section 53 applies only to transfer of immovable property. That is obvious. I told you section from section 38 onwards, you'll be dealing only with immovable property. Now section 53A protects the original transferee, his heirs and assignees against claim to eject them brought by the original transferor, his heirs and assignees. It will not protect if the alleged possession is declared illegal or dealing in that property is forbidden by law or transferee's interests are assailed. Okay, so section 53A protects your transferee. Now, section 53A of the transfer of property provides a shield of protection to proposed transferee to remain in possession against the original owner who has agreed to sell these lands to the transferee if the proposed transferee satisfies the other condition of section 53A. That protection is available as a shield only against the transferor, the vendor, and would disentitle him from disturbing the possession of the transferees who are put in possession pursuant to such an agreement. See, let me explain you with an illustration. A sells his property to B, okay, and there is a contract between A and B. So what happens? B partly performs the contract, okay? Partly, this is not Privy Council, okay? Don't confuse it. Partly performs the contract. So I've written it PC. So B partly performs the contract. Now what happens? A gets another person. Let us assume C. And now A wants to sell his property that he was selling to B to C now. So B says that no, I have partly performed the contract, or ORA section 53A says that willing to perform the contract. Okay, so B is willing to perform the contract. So B says, no, I am partly performing the contract or I am willing to perform the contract. How can you sell your property to C? So A is debarred here from the law. That is, your section 53A provides a shield to the transferee. B enjoys this right in section 53A because the law also protects your transferee here. Law says that B was willing to perform the contract. So now A cannot, you know, turn his back on B and say that no, I'm not giving him property anymore, I'm selling it to B. No, when you have done the contract with B and B is willing to perform the contract or has performed the contract or has partly performed the contract, then A cannot revoke the contract and say that now I'll not be giving my property to B. So this is your doctrine of part performance, and I hope it is clear to you people. So this was all about today. So please keep subscribing, please keep liking, and please keep sharing, and what? Now I'll be taking a section 52 and 53, and yeah, we are on the verge of completing our Transfer of Property Act. So after Transfer of Property Act, I'm thinking I'll be taking your Law of Contract, because this is also a very important subject in PCS-J. So keep studying, folks, and if you have any problem, any question you want to ask me, you're most welcome. You can ask me in the comment section. And thank you for watching the video, and I hope you people liked it. So have a good night.